Welcome everyone, it's Friday, April 9th, 2021. I'm your host Neil, and this is The Big Picture, where I take a closer look at the central themes driving the financial markets and distill them down to actionable insights. On deck for today, we're going to be taking a closer look at the labor market and see what the implications for the stock market might be. We're also going to take a look at the current setup of some of the most important relationships in the market. Namely, we'll be looking at 10-year yields, the U.S. dollar, oil, commodities, some of the sector and factor rotations at play right now. We're also going to take a look at current market positioning. Without further ado, let's jump in. I'll see you on the other side. First up, let's talk about the current setup between some of the most important relationships driving the financial markets, namely U.S. equities, the U.S. dollar, 10-year yields, and commodities. Now, U.S. equities are up across all time frames. So turning to SPY here in the technical analysis portion of the bear matrix, we see equity markets up across all time frames. Right now, looking back towards the beginning of 2020 or so, if we zoom in, we can get a little better handle on where we are right now in the near term. So SPY being the ETF for the S&P 500, which is a broad market index, giving us a pretty good idea of the overall market health and direction. So in the short term, we see that, you know, obviously equities have rocketed higher over the last 2 weeks. It's been on decreased volume and decreased volatility. That tells us a couple things. The decreased volume says that this most recent push higher is starting to lose momentum. It's losing steam. We also see during that same time frame, though, that volatility has come down substantially. Now, when you see price moving up on decreasing volatility, it's usually a healthy sign. It means that this current move up is more likely to continue into the future. But in the very near term, this recent rally higher is starting to get a little overdone. We're reaching overbought levels, as evidenced by the fact that price has reached up and found resistance here at the upper bowl band, coupled with the fact that volume has been drying up as price has increased. So that tells me that we're more likely in the very near term to see a pullback, a mean reversion back to the middle of its range. But in the context of the long-term and mid-term uptrends, that would actually be pretty healthy movement, especially if we saw that on reduced volume. So if price moves back down to the middle or even towards the bottom of its range, and it does that on still kind of depressed volume, and we don't see a big spike in volatility, that would be, to me, another entry signal into U.S. equities. So that's the broad setup in U.S. equities, but we're also seeing some kind of dislocations within the market. Certain sectors showing favor while other ones are falling out of favor. So we'll return to the equities market here in a little bit to talk about, you know, the sector rotations and factor rotations, what those are telling us about the overall health and likely future direction of the stock market. But for now, let's take a look at some of the other asset classes, what their current setup is telling us right now, and the implication of those things on the stock market. Next, let's talk a little bit about the U.S. dollar. Now, in my opinion, this is really at the core of what's happening in the market right now. And this big inflection point going from a long-term downtrend to a mid-term consolidation to a near-term uptrend has wide-ranging implications for the rest of the financial markets. I say this all the time, but if you get the dollar right, you get a lot of things right. The dollar is really an important driver of many of the other asset classes. U.S. equities, for example. When the dollar weakens, it makes U.S. businesses more attractive to foreign investors, holders of foreign currencies, because it makes those investments effectively cheaper to holders of foreign currencies when the dollar weakens against those foreign currencies. So a weakening dollar typically has a beneficial effect on the U.S. stock market because of increased demand from foreign investors. So down dollar is typically a tailwind for the U.S. stock market. Additionally, a down dollar is a beneficial for commodities, because most commodities are priced in U.S. dollars globally, meaning that whenever U.S. dollars are worth less, it requires more of them to purchase the same amount of commodities, right? So oil, for example, if the dollar is in decline, it requires more of those dollars to purchase the same amount of oil, so the price of oil goes up. So I've pulled up UUP here, which is an ETF that tracks the price of the US dollar. And looking at the long-term trend, I mean, obviously very down over the last year or so. And the downtrend here in the dollar, mostly a reaction to fiscal and monetary stimulus. You know, effectively a ton of new money being pumped into the economy devalues the dollar. But if we zoom into the midterm and the near term, we see that trend starting to reverse. So we see the dollar really found a bottom here in early 2021, and it kind of consolidated, washing back and forth, and found another low here in late February. But since then has kicked higher, right? We're seeing this new near-term uptrend in the dollar. So what's changed exactly? I mean, we just had another round of stimulus, another $1.9 trillion. So why is the dollar starting to tick higher? Well, that has everything to do with expectations. See, the market was expecting that second round of stimulus, that $1.9 trillion. We've been hearing about that since late 2020. And even though it didn't come into effect until pretty recently, the price of the dollar was already reflecting that second round of stimulus prior to it actually entering the economy, right? So now there's not really any expectations for more stimulus in the near term. So all that downward pressure that was on the dollar by way of fiscal and monetary stimulus is waning. And now the market is looking forward to, well, what's likely to happen next and what is the effect that that's likely to have on the dollar. One last point to make about this current move in the dollar is that we're also starting to see a shift in market positioning around the dollar. Here we're looking at the commitment of traders reports following the US dollar index. This chart gives us an idea of how the market is positioned around the dollar, right? So whenever these bars go negative, that means there's a net short position in the dollar broadly across the market. And when it flips positive, it means that there's a net long position in the dollar, meaning the market is starting to support this up move in the dollar. We see that right now it has a 1-year Z score of 0.77. So it's not at an extreme right now, but we see the trend going from the market was net short dollars for the beginning of 2021. And that's starting to flip to net long positioning, meaning more of the market is bullish on the dollar moving forward than bearish. So the market's starting to pick up on this recent push higher in the dollar and supporting that move. Well, that takes us to our next point, the 10-year yield. The 10-year yield has been up across all time frames. And this is a proxy for overall interest rates, right? The 10-year yield is the main indicator of the long end of the yield curve. So with 10-year yields up across all time frames, it signals to us that investors' expectations of inflation are on the rise. So what's the implication of a rising yield on the US dollar? Well, if you think about the entire world right now, bond yields globally are extremely low. And in fact, most of the world is in negative interest rate territory right now. So with US yields on the rise, we have pretty attractive yields here in the United States. That means there's going to be an increased demand for US Treasury bonds, and that foreign investors are going to need to exchange their foreign currencies for US dollars in order to purchase treasuries, right? So that they can chase those attractive yields. That increased demand for the dollar is going to increase the price of the dollar. So one major tailwind for the dollar, and no expectations of any major headwinds for the dollar moving forward in the near term. So while I'm not 100% convinced that the dollar charges higher from here, I'd say it's more likely that the dollar either consolidates or moves up from here, at least in the near term, and so long as treasury yields keep rising. Lastly, I want to touch on commodities. Now, commodities showing mixed trends right now. We're still in a prevailing long-term and mid-term uptrend, but a recent near-term downtrend developing. Let's have a look at the chart. So here we're looking at DBC, which is a broad commodities ETF. Looking back to the beginning of 2020, we see, you know, the sell-off from the coronavirus here in March 2020, and commodities broadly up substantially over that time. Again, the long-term and mid-term uptrends pretty prevalent here. But we're seeing in the near term as we zoom in, that price of commodities broadly has started to consolidate, meaning, you know, we reached a peak and then it's kind of washed back and forth, moving mostly sideways since late February here. Now, that coincides pretty closely to this move in the dollar, right? Where the long-term trend and midterm trend in the dollar is down, while the long-term and midterm trend in commodities is up. Again, that has to do with the strong inverse correlation between commodities and the dollar. And to reiterate, that inverse correlation is due to the fact that commodities globally are priced in the dollar. So when there's a decline in the strength of the dollar, it requires more dollars to purchase the same amount of commodities, pushing the price of those commodities up. So I've added the dollar below our commodities chart here so we can get an idea of how these things have trended relative to one another. So if we pull back to, you know, the beginning of 2020 or so, we can pretty clearly see that strong inverse correlation on display here. You know, as the dollar declined over 2020, commodities rose broadly. And now, as we zoom into the near term, we see the movement of both of these assets moving in the opposite direction, where, you know, the dollar kind of consolidated for a few months here and started pressing higher in late February as commodities started to consolidate and move lower. So continued strength in the dollar is likely to cause continued weakness in the commodities space. Now, that's a broad statement. There are a ton of different individual commodities within this broad basket of commodities, namely, you know, oil, steel, lumber, all kinds of different things that are likely to react to changes in the dollar differently. Plus, each of the underlying components of this commodities index also has their own forces of supply and demand and other fundamental forces driving their prices independently of the dollar. But definitely something to be considering regarding any commodity exposures that you have in your portfolio. To wrap up our 30,000 foot view here, let's talk a little bit about economic data. Last week on The Big Picture, we talked about some of the favorable reports we got out from the ISM manufacturing data. Good news for the manufacturing sector broadly. We also had favorable retail sales and other growth-oriented economic data, indicating likely strength ahead for the U.S. economy, at least as far as the growth picture is concerned. Also, we saw inflation starting to pick up, namely in the PPI commodities report and also just in the price of commodities broadly. So we are seeing inflation creeping in. That has been influencing the direction of yields, which again is a proxy for investors' expectations of inflation. So once again, growth and inflation both positive here in the United States. This week, we also got some employment data out. So let's take a look at that and see how that's likely to affect our economic outlook. All right, fun times with economic data. First up, we're gonna look at the all employees total non-farm payrolls. You know, we see that absolutely plummeted back in the coronavirus fallout early 2020. And since then has been on the rise, meaning that the employment picture in the United States is getting better. Still negative on a year-over-year basis, but trending to the upside. And, you know, the most recent data point was from March. So that's really the last difficult year-over-year comparison that we're going to get because looking back, we didn't really see the employment picture in the United States plummet until the April data came out in 2020. So the most recent data is comparing to March of 2020, which again, you know, hadn't really felt the effects of the coronavirus fallout in the labor market just yet. So we are coming up on a time when we're gonna have some seriously favorable year-over-year comps, right? Year-over-year base effects. So this year-over-year rate of change is likely to increase exponentially in the next couple of months. We also see that the sequential rate of change, right, the rate of change from February 2021 to March 2021 is up 0.64%, and that increase in the rate of change is accelerating period over period or sequentially. So that means that not only is the employment picture getting better, it's getting better at a faster rate. So all systems go as far as total non-farm payrolls are concerned. What are the implications of that for the stock market? Well, the more people that are working and have more disposable income, the more they're likely to spend that in the economy. So that's a tailwind for the economy in general and for the companies that operate within it, the stock market. Turning to the overall unemployment level, we see kind of the inverse of that. Whereas non-farm payrolls went up, the unemployment level is coming down. Again, that's happening at a faster rate, with a sequential acceleration of 68.45% and a sequential rate of change down 2.63%. Again, you know, we still aren't even getting that favorable year-over-year comparison that we're likely to see next month. So more than likely, the employment picture is just going to continue to get better. And that's going to provide a persistent tailwind for the U.S. economy and for the stock market. So the economy is looking pretty good, and we're coming up on a period where we're going to have some really easy year-over-year comparisons. So the economic data is likely to continue to look even better over the next several months. We also have a better idea of the central themes at play in the market, the intermarket analysis between U.S. equities, the dollar, 10-year yields, and commodities. So now that the big picture is starting to come into view, let's drill down a little further. Let's go to the 15,000-foot view and take a closer look at the sector rotations and factor rotations to see how the individual components of the stock market are performing. Jumping into the sector rotations here in the Barra Matrix, let's start by looking at the long-term trends and how funds have flowed through the market, now working our way through time from the furthest out to the most recent. So looking at the 12-month return, we see metals and mining really, you know, leading the pack, leading the market higher. A 12-month return of what's this, you know, over 100%. Looking at, you know, up 127% over the last 12 months. But turning towards the intermediate term time frame, the 3 and 6 month returns, we see a little bit of discrepancy there, some rotations. We saw energy firmly take the seat as the market leader over the 3 and 6 month time frames. Metals and mining still performing well over the last 6 months, but that strength starting to wane as we get closer, nearer in time, right? With the metals and mining kind of in the middle of the pack in the 3 month time frame. We also see metals and mining as a market laggard here in the most recent 1 week and 1 month time frames. So a slow rotation out of metals and mining, we'll see if this near-term down move turns into something more, right? And we're starting to see that with metals and mining kind of in the middle of the pack here in the 3 months. That's where the real inflection point is for me, where we're going from the near term to the midterm. So we're seeing that near term weakness in metals and mining bleeding into the intermediate term, the midterm, right? So why is that exactly? What's happening? What, you know, caused all this strength in the long term, and what's causing this weakness in the near and starting to be the midterms as well? So you gotta think about the individual components of metals and mining. Now, some of the top holdings for metals and mining I have here is, you know, Newcorp Corporation, Cleveland Cliffs, US Steel. I mean, those three components right there make up over 15% of XME. So very steel tilted, and steel has performed really well over the last year in particular. And to me, that relates to this reflation trade, right? Where, you know, we had what we talked about earlier, weakness in the dollar, propping up prices for commodities. In our instance here, we're talking about steel, and you know, that's been a huge tailwind for the price of steel, which has been a huge tailwind for the profitability of steel related companies. So metals and mining showing significant strength over the 12-month and 6-month timeframes. But we're starting to see a rotation out of that reflation trade where, you know, commodities had run up so high, the dollar had come down so far, the dollar's starting to make an uptrend, commodities are consolidating. So we're seeing the near-term and mid-term trends more down for the metals and mining industry. So again, this inflection point in the dollar is going to have wide-ranging implications, particularly on metals and mining, you know, so we're going to really want to watch out for the dollar's next move. If the dollar continues higher, it's going to be a continued persisting headwind for metals and mining. We want to watch if this near-term weakness turns into, you know, mid-term and long-term weakness. And with metals and mining kind of in the middle of the pack on the 3-month return, we're starting to see that happen. But these charts update every day, so we're looking at the trailing 3 months. You know, this isn't last quarter or anything, so we don't have to wait 2 months to figure out if this is going to happen. Every day these charts are updated, and we'll have a clearer picture of how metals and mining has performed, you know, across the near term, mid term, long term. So watching the dollar and its influence on metals and mining. We also see energy kind of the same story, where over the 3-month and 6-month time frames, it took firm market leadership. And that's starting to wane as well, where in the 1 week and 1 month returns, energy is actually the market laggard. So pretty much the same story there, where the down dollar has propped up the price of oil, has made oil-related companies more profitable in the long term. So that's why we're seeing that strength in the 3 and 6 months. But those things turning over right now. So right now, it's still just a near-term move. So we'll see if this is just, energy and metals and mining digesting their long-term gains and building up for another push higher, or if this near-term rotation turns into mid-term and long-term weakness. And again, the direction of the dollar is going to be hugely influential on how this moves going forward. Also of note in our sector rotation study here is consumer discretionary and tech. Now, over the 12-month time frame, the long term, both sectors have performed really well in the number 2 and 3 spots as far as market leadership. We saw that really starting to wane in the 3 and 6 month, with tech in the middle of the pack and discretionary on the bottom half of the pack here. So waning leadership from tech and discretionary, that started out as a near-term move and led to a intermediate-term move, right? But we're starting to see in the near term that those things are turning higher again, right? Over the 1 month time frame, tech and discretionary, the number 1 and 2 market leaders. So my perspective on that is that we've been in this reflationary environment that's been conducive to growth in the discretionary and technology spaces. We've had fiscal stimulus putting money in consumers' pockets. We've had low interest rates being favorable for the funding of new projects for technology companies. So those things have been a favorable tailwind in the long term. We started to see the 10-year yield start to creep higher in the last 6-8 months. And I think initially the market got scared out of technology and discretionary because of those rising interest rates. That's typically a headwind for technology and discretionary. So we saw what started out as a near-term down move in discretionary and tech move into an intermediate-term down move. But after the initial move down in tech and discretionary, price really just started to move sideways. It consolidated there on decreasing volume and decreasing volatility. We're starting to see a breakout to the upside as the big picture backdrop kind of improves for those sectors. So particularly, we're getting a ton of really good economic data because we have really easy year-over-year comparisons, right? I think people are starting to get used to this whole idea of rising yields. The fact is, the market consensus is that technology in particular has a hard time performing well in rising interest rate environments. But the back test proves that that's just not really true. Technology absolutely can perform well in rising interest rate environments. And the same goes for discretionary. If we take a step back from the fact that yields are moving higher at a faster clip, we see that, really yields and interest rates are still relatively low on an absolute value basis. So taking out new debt to fund new projects is still relatively cheap for companies in these two sectors. So I think right now we have more favorable tailwinds for tech and discretionary than we do headwinds, and that's showing up in this near-term move. Also, with volatility down so much across broad equities, some of the fear is coming out of the market and money is rotating into these risk-on assets, right? Parts of the market that typically have higher risk and higher reward, namely tech and discretionary. So what is all that telling us about where we are in the business cycle and what's likely to happen next? If you've seen our sector rotations or business cycle videos, you'll recognize this chart to my left here. This basically shows the various economic regimes, right? The short-term debt cycle, the fluctuations of economic growth, right? And how the various sectors of the market typically perform during those economic regimes. So the short-term business cycle is described by a trough leading to an expansion, leading to a market peak, a contraction, and back to another trough full cycle. So we've been in a long-term, the longest in history, in fact, bull market, right? Since late 2009, really. So we've been in the expansionary phase of the business cycle. Typically during the expansionary phase, you see outperformance by consumer discretionary, tech, industrials, and basic materials, which metals and mining is a major component of. When you start nearing that market peak, you see energy start to take market leadership. So we found ourselves in this interesting place where technology and consumer discretionary were kind of the market leaders for a while in the long-term view. And that started to give way to strength in industrials and basic materials in particular, right? Metals and mining being a major component of the basic materials sector broadly. And then we started to see leadership by energy as well, indicating that we might be reaching a market peak. But now it looks like we're starting to kind of slip back down the slope of the expansionary phase where consumer discretionary and technology are taking leadership once again. So we got this kind of fake out for a while that we might be nearing a market peak, but with discretionary and tech leading the market higher again, it looks like for now it's all systems go. We're likely to continue this expansionary phase at least into the next few months, especially given that we're coming up on a period this year where our year-over-year comparisons to last year are going to be really easy. The market was in shambles last year in response to the COVID-19 fallout. So here we are comparing everything to that time and things are looking better. Generally, there's a feeling of less risk in the market with reduced volatility. So again, funds flowing back into risk on assets. And if you want to learn more about why these different sectors respond to different economic regimes, take a look at our business cycle video and our sector rotations video, where you can learn more about the fundamental reasons why these sectors perform differently given varying economic backdrops, big picture backdrops, right? And with that in mind, we'll want to keep an eye out for a return to basic materials and energy leadership. If we see that, it's usually in response to rising inflation, right? As inflation rises, the cost of things that we need rises, namely oil, which bolsters the energy market. That's why we kind of hit a market peak usually with energy leading the way. And in response to that, typically the long end of the yield curve, rates in general tend to rise to rein in that inflation, right? To make up for the erosive effects of inflation. So it's really the rising yields that are going to have an influential cascade effect throughout the sectors of the market. And we've already noted that yields are on the rise. They've been rising pretty steadily for 6-8 months now, really accelerating their rise in the last couple months. So at what point do yields get high enough to again scare the market out of risk assets? Right now, we're seeing risk on, the market moving back into those assets. But if we see inflation creep higher and eventually accelerate higher faster than expectations, that's going to have some serious implications on the sector rotations. But last week on The Big Picture, we talked about how there's still slack in the economy by way of the capacity utilization, meaning that right now, the United States is more or less underutilizing its capacity, right? Not meeting its capacity. So that has the effect of absorbing inflation. So my view is that until we see that slack come out of the economy, inflation isn't likely to spike higher, accelerating faster than expectations would predict. So I think we have several months in the all clear as far as inflation and interest rates rising at a rate that starts to scare the market. With all of that in mind, let's talk about what to watch this week. So last week brought more positive signs for tech and discretionary and more weakness for metals, mining, and energy. So definitely keeping an eye on the rotation there. See if the near-term strength in tech and discretionary persists and turns into a stronger intermediate term and a resumption of the long-term market leadership in those two spaces. The direction of the US dollar is again the $64,000 question right now. If the near-term strength continues, it could cause a cascade effect influencing the reversal of the current big picture themes, putting more downward pressure on metals and mining and energy. So definitely important to be watching this move in the dollar. We're also seeing yields bouncing off the low end of their range, continuing a series of higher highs and higher lows. For now, yields look more likely to continue higher on inflation expectations and rising commodity prices. So I think economic slack is going to absorb much of that inflation in the near term. So it's not likely to accelerate at a scary pace here in the next few months, at least, but definitely something to be keeping a close eye on and the implications that rising yields have on the various sectors of the market. We'll be watching broad commodities prices for signs of weakness, and a rising dollar is likely to accelerate that trend. And again, watching technology and discretionary for further signs of strength. Always keep in mind, though, that this is just what the market's telling us right now. Next week could be a very different story. You know, we might see a huge pop in energy, metals, and mining, or some big sell-off in tech and discretionary. So always keeping a finger on the pulse of the big picture here, not so that we can outsmart the market and tell it what to do, but so that we can always work with what the market is giving us, what it's telling us right now. So you always want to put emphasis on the long-term trend and the intermediate-term trend, and then consider what the near-term trend is telling us about what's likely to happen in the midterm, long-term, right? The near-term leads to the midterm, leads to the long-term. Right now, the long-term is still saying energy and metals and mining are the, you know, market leaders. So this near-term move we're keeping a close eye on is definitely favoring tech and discretionary right now. But, you know, that could rotate next week or it could continue higher. So keeping an eye on the dollar, on yields, on sector rotations, these are the things that make up the big picture that help us create that backdrop so that we can make smarter investment decisions. Based on all of that, here's what I'll be doing this week. Sector rotation is favoring tech and discretionary in the near term. And, you know, over the long term, it's also performed really well. It's that intermediate term where there was weakness and a kind of extended consolidation in those two spaces. So I'm looking at that as an opportunity to buy on weakness. Any weakness this week, I'll probably start legging in a small way into the, you know, back into these sectors. And I'll be looking to volume and volatility to help guide my decisions around those things. So check out some of our other educational content around technical and quantitative analysis to learn more about my process around that. But very briefly, if I see near-term weakness, as in like a couple of days weakness in technology and discretionary that have performed well in the last 1 week, 1 month, and that weakness happens on reduced volume and reduced volatility, I'll see that as a buying opportunity. In both broader ETFs associated with tech and discretionary, as well as individual companies in those spaces. Additionally, and something we didn't really touch on today was financials. Bank stocks in particular have a favorable tailwind in rising interest rate environments. And right now, you know, we're seeing yields continue higher, higher highs, higher lows. And as of right now, today, the 10-year yield is bouncing off the low end of its range. So my very near-term view is that yields are likely to continue higher over the next 1 and 2 weeks. And that's going to have a favorable tailwind in financials. So looking for individual components within the financial space, again, particularly banks that have attractive technical setups, I think is a high probability play this week. So I'll be looking at some financials, tech, and discretionary. I'll also be keeping an eye on some of my longer-term holdings in energy and metals and mining. Trimming gains where it makes sense, maybe adding to some of those positions, you know, if that makes sense. Again, I rely heavily on my quantitative and technical signals as far as my entry and exits into those positions. So the big picture here really dedicated to the 30,000 and 15,000 foot views of the markets. Whereas when we get into the signaling process, that's the ground level, the down and the top down analysis. That's really stepping into the forest and examining the trees, identifying those attractive setups in the individual investment vehicles. So stay tuned with Market Barometrics for more on that. And subscribe to the website to get deeper insights as to the individual investment vehicles you might consider in the most attractive sectors and industries of the market. That's it for today, folks. Obviously, and as per usual, plenty to be thinking about in the markets and plenty of opportunity available. So hop on over to marketbarometrics.com where you can access all of our free educational content and the tools and training that you need in order to keep track of the market yourself, to keep your finger on the pulse of what's shaking and moving in the financial markets. Don't forget to hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you guys all next week on The Big Picture.